They were singing, I can see the young version of Sister Evelyn. Parehong-pareho, eh, no? Kay Sam, and then the younger version of Sister Lily. Kay Francis, and Badong, of course, kay Michael. So, we already know what they will look like when they grow up. And then as I look at JL, I can see my younger version. So we already know the future of JL. So we thank God for His goodness, for giving us another year that we can continue to serve Him and worship Him in spirit and in truth. We thank God for His, indeed, our God is a faithful God. He never ceases to be faithful. And I hope and I pray that we can be able to give our faithfulness to the Lord without any reservation, because everything that we do for God should be done with our best, because He deserves it. When whatever the Lord does for us is always His best. Has given us the best gift, that is His Son, and the best gift that we possess, eternal life, and of course the best destination, heaven, and we're going to enjoy everything by the grace of God. That time will come, but until we are here on earth, there are things that we need to do in order to glorify Him, and so that we can make Him smile and happy as He look at the things that we are doing in life. So we thank God for 2019, and we are filled with anticipation for 2020, for whatever the Lord will do. I hope and I pray that no matter what happens in 2020, we need to understand that it is for our good as we love God and as we are called according to the purpose of God. So thank God for opening our malapit nang mawalan kayo ng privilege, konti na lang. We thank God for opening our year with a rebuke of a reminder regarding how we should worship God. And I follow it up, and I'm going to follow it up by telling you that we need to enjoy the Word of God more this year than how we have enjoyed it before. So shall we stand up and we will pray, as we have already read our text in Jeremiah chapter 15 to 21. Father, we are grateful for another year that you have given us. We thank you, O God, for everything that happened in 2019. There were ups and downs. There were doubts. There were confirmations. There were sins. There were forgiveness. And we thank you, O God, because what is constant in 2019 is your love for us and your faithfulness. We thank you, O God, that you never changes, even though, Lord, many things may change in our lives, but you will remain constant until all throughout eternity. We thank you, O God, for gathering us even today so that we can continue to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, please speak to us and give us your grace that we may enjoy your word more than ever, O God, and that we will learn more and apply more of these things in our lives, so that, Lord, we can be a channel of blessing to those people who might be looking for the way, who might be looking for the light, or who may be experiencing problems, crisis, distress, anxieties in life, that we may be able to comfort them as we were comforted by your word since we got saved. Thank you, O God. Give us wisdom. And as we preach and as we listen, may you be glorified in our midst. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you very much. So, as a background, we have read Jeremiah chapter 15, 15 to 21, and we can see that Jeremiah has been in a state of backsliding. But then the good thing is that there is something that is always available in order to help us arrest our slide and help us go back to the right path. And that is the Word of God. Amen. In verse number 16, Jeremiah said that thy words were found and I did eat them. Meaning to say that Jeremiah allowed the Word of God once again to be a part of his life. Something that he ingested, something that permeates his system, something that enlivened his spirit, and something that pushed him to keep on keeping on for God. We need to understand that unlike our in our time and in our days, Jeremiah is facing a very rough time, a very rough time to fulfill your calling from the Lord, because Israel is in a state of deep backsliding. If you have read the whole book of Jeremiah, you will see there that Jeremiah even proclaimed to the people and rebuked them that they no longer blush even if they will commit sin, that they no longer care what they are doing before God, because they do not really give God something or some respect in their lives. So Jeremiah was sent by the Lord to these people who do not want to listen to the word of God. And then because of that, Jeremiah got so discouraged, and he even asked himself and God, "Who believe my report? Nobody is listening to me anymore." And in the many years of proclaiming the word of God, it is as if not even one is turning back from idols in order to serve and worship the true and the living God. That is why Jeremiah is also known as the weeping prophet. He wept for two reasons. Number one is because nobody is listening to the word of God anymore. And number two is because he's having a hard time fulfilling his calling from the Lord, and he got so discouraged that he wanted to quit. But Jeremiah said that the word of God is like a fire in his bone, that he cannot stay, that he cannot keep, but to preach the word of God. So the word of God is very important in our lives as a Christian. We are going to experience so many things, but no matter how bad things may be, the word of God will always help us through those times, because of the truths, because of the principles, because of the doctrines, because of the encouragement that the word of God can give to each and every one of us. Amen. Amen. So because Jeremiah found the word of God, and because Jeremiah ate the word of God, it has become his joy and it has become his rejoicing. So you can see that even in the midst of the hardest of times, the word of God can give us comfort. Amen. Even though we are at our wit's end, the word of God can give us enlightenment. And because of this, Jeremiah again turned his back, turned back to God, and he kept on serving the Lord. And because as Jeremiah went through the word of God, he was assured by God that they will fight you. They are going to despise you. They are going to put you in prison. But God said, nobody will prevail against thee, because I am going to protect you. And these promises can only be found from the word of God. Amen. You see, sometimes in our lives, we will experience things that we do not understand. That no matter how deep we dig through, it is as if nothing is making any sense at all. But when we apply our faith in the word of God, then comfort will come into our hearts, and we will be encouraged, and we will be encouraged by God to keep on keeping on, because no matter how dark it is, there is always a light at the end of the tunnel. Even though how strong the storm may be, then there is going to be a silver lining, so that another day will come into our lives. A new hope, a new day, a new year, a turning, a new leaf. God is always going to give us something new if we are going to always dig deeper into the word of God. Amen. Amen. So Jeremiah ate God's word. Jeremiah enjoyed the word of God. And I hope and I pray that in the year 2020, we are going to enjoy the word of God more. And like Jeremiah, no matter how dark our world is becoming, we will always shine as a light because of the help of God's word. Amen. Amen. So we are to live for the Lord and serve Him successfully. We must give the Bible its rightful place in our life. You see, sometimes there are things that are so important, and sometimes these things are not even our priorities in life. You see, in order for us to become a joyful Christian, we need to make the Word of God a mighty part of our lives. You will not find a Bible character who became joyful, happy, contented, successful without making the Word of God a great part of their lives. But listen, it is not enough that we read and believe the Word of God, because it is possible to believe it and yet neglect the Word of God, as we can see in the lives of many Christians. So many Christians, if you ask them, they know more from the Word of God. There are so many things that they know. They know that you need to honor God with the first day of the week, and that is Sunday. They know that they need to honor God by worshiping Him in spirit and in truth. They know that God commanded us to be together and not to neglect our assembling together. People knows that. People believes that, but they neglect to do it. So knowing God's word is not enough. What's important is that we need to apply the word of God in our lives. Amen. Amen. Like what James says. What kind of a person is he who will look at the mirror, will see something wrong in his face, and then just leave without trying to fix it? So the word of God is not only to be read and to be believed, but the word of God eventually and more importantly must be applied in our lives. Amen. Amen. So the essential thing is that we enjoy it and delight in the word of God. You see, you can read something that you do not enjoy. Like for example, I was in college a long time ago, and there are what we call required readings. You will read them for the sake of getting grades, but you do not enjoy them. That's why there are things that we've studied before that we have no idea what are they now. Why? Because after we got the grade, we have just forgotten about it. But the Word of God should be different. When we read the Word of God, understand the Word of God, it must make an indelible mark in our lives by applying it. Amen. Something that we applied is something that is hard to forget. You see, in life there are things that are hard to forget. First love. Because you experience it. Maybe until now you remember the name of your first love. Ayun, yung pangalan ng first love mo, kapatid. Ay. Mili raw eh. Tanong tayo ng honest, anong name ng first love mo, Sister Maribel? Mga sinungaling ang mga tao rito. Ako, ang pangalan ng first love ko, Christina. Hindi ako sinungaling. Sinasabi ko, ano pangalan ng first love mo, Andre? Christina rin. Oh! Apir tayo dyan. Oh, apir. Oh! Sabi ko sa inyo eh. So there are things that are hard to forget in our lives. Your first kiss. You still remember that? Your first fight. Do you remember your... Teka muna, nasa first kiss pa kayo eh. Nag-move on na ako eh. Your first fight. Amen? Do you remember your first fight? There are so many things that are hard to forget in our lives, ladies and gentlemen. Why? Because we experience them. And listen to me. If we will allow the Bible to be experienced by us, then we are not going to forget it, because experiencing the Word of God is experiencing the Son of God. Amen? And that's the reason why we will never forget the Lord Jesus Christ, is because we experience Him. He is residing in our hearts through the person of the Holy Spirit, and He has been a part of our lives. So there must be delight in enjoying the Word of God, and we should delight in the instances wherein God is illuminating our mind and making us understand the truth from the Word of God. You see, no unbeliever can enjoy the Word of God simply because they cannot understand it. And you cannot enjoy what you cannot understand. And the reason why Christians can enjoy the Word of God is because the Holy Spirit is helping us to understand the Word of God. And understanding the mind of God is the greatest thing that we can experience in our lives. Amen. Just look at the immense benefits that we can get if we delight ourselves in the Word of God. Joshua 1:8. In Joshua 1:8, the Bible says, "This book of the law shall not depart out of our mouth," and then there must be meditation. And once we know the Word of God, we meditate upon the Word of God, and we apply the Word of God, then the result is good success. So there is no success apart from the Word of God. I don't care who you are. I don't care how rich you are. I don't care how powerful you are. If your life is not governed by the Word of God, then you are not a successful person. Because success, good success, can only come from the Word of God. In Deuteronomy chapter 11, verses 18 to 21, if you're taking note, you can read this at home or it will be flashed and you can read it. But in Deuteronomy 11, 18 to 21, the Bible or the Word of God can give us long life filled with blessing. So you see, if we know the Word of God, it can give us longevity of life. Why? By knowing the Word of God, we can avoid those things that can destroy our body. We will avoid places that will put us in danger. We will avoid people that might destroy our selves. We are going to avoid doing things that may jeopardize our very existence here on earth. That is why when we read and apply the Word of God, then it will give us long life filled with the blessing from the Lord. In Psalms 1, the Bible says, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, but his delight is in the law of the Lord." So there is blessing when we know the Word of God. The Bible says, "Blessed is he that read the Word of God." Amen. So merely reading the Word of God will already give us blessing. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 15 to 17, we can see that reading the Word of God can make us wise unto salvation. It can equip us for service. It will enable us to do the will of God, and it will give us wisdom in order to do good works in our life. So without the Word of God, apart from the Word of God, it is impossible to please God. Amen? Because only faith can please God, and faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So you remove the Word of God, then we are nothing. We will be nowhere. We will not be able to find any good thing in life without the Word of God. So that is why we need to give importance to the Word of God. Like Jeremiah, when he found the Word of God, he made the Word of God a part of his life. He ate it so that it's going to be a part of him, never to be taken away anymore. No matter what happens from that day on until the time that he was taken by the Lord. So how are we going to enjoy the Word of God? How can we enjoy reading and studying the Word of God? Maybe may I give you several suggestions. Number one, in order to enjoy the Word of God, we must know the author of the book. Amen. We must know the author of the book. You see, when we read the written word, we will come to know the incarnate word. Look at John chapter 1, verse 1 and 14. The Bible says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." And in verse number 14, the Bible says, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." So you see, if we are going to read the written word, then we are going to know the incarnate word. The Bible says, "Search the scripture, for in them ye think that ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me." There is no way of knowing Jesus without the Word of God. And there is no way of knowing the Word of God without Jesus. Because if we will read the Word of God, it will point us to Jesus, And as we follow and listen to Jesus, He will point us to the Word of God. So you cannot separate the two because they are one and the same. Look at Luke chapter 24, verse 27. 24:27. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, He expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning Himself. You see, the Bible is about the author. The Bible is about the Lord Jesus Christ. So when we read the Bible, we are going to know the author. And once we know the author, He will tell us to read His book. So we cannot separate the two. They must always go together. Amen? Amen. We cannot think of the one without the other. You see, the Bible can be enjoyed in so many ways. When I was still an unbeliever, I had an insomnia. I used the Bible for... I used to read the Bible so that I will fall asleep. And I enjoy it because it can make me sleep. Because it seems that the devil will cure your insomnia as long as you're not going to read the Word of God for a long time. And reading the Bible for a cure for insomnia will not give you anything at all. You can enjoy the Bible as a literature because it is a great piece of literature. You can see history in the Word of God. You can see prophecy from the Word of God. You can see poetry from the Word of God. You can see anecdotes from the Word of God. You can read stories from the Word of God. There are so many things to enjoy from the Word of God as a literary book. But in order to enjoy its fullest sense, we must know Him whom knowing will give us eternal life. Amen. You see, it's different when you're reading a book, and you know the author. You can easily relate to what you are actually reading. But without knowing the author, sometimes it is very hard to really enjoy that book because of the mystery that is shrouding the author of that book, especially if the author of that book is quite a mysterious person or a person that is that has a reputation that is not good. Like for example, if somebody wrote you a love letter without you knowing who is it, there may be some shivering and quivering, but there is not a full sense of enjoyment. Why? Because you do not know the person. Do you know what I'm talking about? Like, for example, Brother Deo received a love letter with no name. He may say that, well, I'm flattered. He may say that he enjoys some of the words. But until and unless he finally knows the author, he will not really know if he will enjoy it or not. What if the author is a example? Mahirap magsalita. Di ba? Oo, kaya wag na lang. Ayan. Parang si Brother Darwin naka-receive ng love letter. Paano kung ang letter ay galing kay? Ah, di ba? Naisip niyo ba? Nag-isip kayo ng pangalan tapos nagkakaroon kayo ng reaction. The same thing. So if we know the author of the book that we are reading, we can fully enjoy that book. Amen? And praise God, because as saved people, we know the author of this book. And the author of this book is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So as we read the Word of God, then we can enjoy because there is that knowledge of that author in us. As we know Him, He gave us eternal life. John 17 and verse number 3. The Bible says in John 17:3, and this is eternal, and this is life eternal, that they might know Thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom Thou hast sent. So as we know the author, and as the author gave us eternal life, then we can fully enjoy reading the Word of God because of what the author did for us and through us and for our lives. Look at Luke chapter 24, verse number 32. Not only by knowing the author, but there is something that that we must see whenever we read the Word of God. 24:32 of Luke, and this is, that is 17:3 of John. Luke 24:32. Ito kasi dapat tama ang pronunciation para malaman niya. Baka trick ako, maghanap ng puno Oo na. Luke 24:32. Yeah. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way and while he opened to us the scriptures? You see, listen, if we are saved and then the word of God is read or is preached to us, there is a burning in our hearts. There is that emotion. Although we are not emotional, but you cannot remove that emotion of joy and happiness when we are hearing the word of God. Compare this to Jeremiah 15:16. This is what Jeremiah felt. Thy words were found, and I did eat them, and thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of mine heart. For I am called by thy name, O Lord, God of hosts. So, there is that yearning for the word of God, and when we finally read or hear the word of God, then we can feel something inside of us. Why? Because the author is living in us, and the author is telling us that's true, and that should be a part of your life. So if you do not enjoy the word of God, maybe there is nothing in you that enjoys the word of God. That is why we were rebuked a while ago. That why is it that we can, you know, sit for hours watching the Inception, watching television series? Naalala ko si Maribel na may napanood kaming series, yung Sea. Ang bida ron, si Aquaman. Isang season pa lang. Episode 1 to 8. Nung matapos na, sabi ni Maribel, bitin! Kanya, kailan pa kaya yung next season yan? Eh, nakalagay doon, baka 2020 o 2021. Sabi niya, tagal pa naman. O biro mo yung excitement. Look at the excitement. Look at the anticipation of watching a series. And many of you have experienced that. Some of you are even watching those that you cannot understand, but you just have to read the words. Like the Korean telenovelas. And you're so excited about it. You are going to set aside a time so that you can watch it, so that you can enjoy it. But the question is, why is it that we are getting weary of the Word of God? Well, Pastor, because the things that we are hearing from behind the pulpit is almost the same. That the preaching is being repeated again and again and again and again. It is as if nothing is new. Well, listen to me. The Bible says there is nothing new under the sun. And I cannot preach a different preaching. Why? Because we get our preaching from the same book. And there is only one truth, an absolute truth, and that is the Word of God. But the question is this, why is it that you are hearing the same thing again and again and again and again, and we are not applying it in our lives? That should be the question that we need to ask ourselves. Sabi niyo, Pastor, but paulit-ulit? Kasi paulit-ulit ka rin. Amen? But Pastor, lagi yan ang pinipreach mo kasi lagi yan ang nilalabag mo. Same thing. So that is the reason why we need to enjoy the Word of God, and only the Holy Spirit can make us enjoy His Word. Amen? That is the reason why we need to be sure that we know the author, and as we know the author, then surely we are going to enjoy the book of the author. Number two, know that the Bible is not an ordinary book. Know that the Bible is not an ordinary book. Why? Because the Bible is the Word of God. Amen? It is not the words of men. It is not authored by men, although it were written by men, because God asked this man to write about his word. But the Bible is completely holy, the word of God. Amen. And therefore, it is fully inspired from Genesis to Revelation. You see, some people believe that the Bible contains the word of God. No, it does not only contain the word of God, but the Bible is purely 100% unadulterated word of God. Amen. No words of men, no words of angels, no words of the devil. But pastor, in Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3, we saw there that the devil spake and he said something. So that is the word of the devil. No, it is the word of God. The word of God told us that the devil said. So it is purely the word of God. When Job said in the Bible, it is God telling us that Job said. But the one who told us what Job said is God. So therefore, it is the word of God. When Judas have spoken in the Bible, he actually have not spoken, but God told us that this is what Judas said. That is why this is purely 100% the word of God. Never a word came from men, from angels, or any other entity in the universe, but the Bible is purely the word of God. That is why Hebrews says the word of God is quick and powerful. It is alive. There are not so many books that can change the life of a person, but the word of God. It changes the life of a murderer, the Apostle Paul. It changes the life of a person who committed treason against his country, Matthew, the tax collector. It changes the life of a rebellious person, Simon the Zealot. It changes the life of a whore, Mary Magdalene. The Bible can change the life of a person if we are going to heed the word of God. Amen. So that is why this is not an ordinary book. Therefore, it is authoritative in our lives. Failing to obey the word of God will bring consequences, while obeying the word of God will bring blessings in our lives. So it is not an ordinary book. It is an extraordinary book. That is why if you entertain doubts about the word of God, you cannot enjoy it. Why? Because you will not know what is true and what is not true. That is why when people, even pastors, will say behind the pulpit that the word of God is inspired in the original, telling us that what we are holding is not the original, therefore it is not inspired, therefore it is not infallible, then the question is, who are we to say this portion is right and this portion is wrong? Therefore, there is no absolute truth anymore. And if there is no absolute truth, then there is no authority in our lives. That is why we must put faith in the word of God that this is wholly true. And nothing in the word of God is erroneous, because the author is perfect. And the author never commit mistakes. You see, it will bring joy if we will put our trust and confidence fully and wholly in the word of God. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 16. The word of God claims that it is perfect, that it came from God. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. You see, you will profit from the word of God for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. So all scripture is given by inspiration of God. Therefore, it came from God. And if it is from God, then we can trust it. Look at 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 21. 2 Peter 1, 21. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved. without the movement, or without them being moved by the Spirit of God, then they will not speak. Without them being moved by the Holy Spirit, they will not write. Without them being moved or dictated by the Holy Spirit, they cannot produce. So men are merely instruments in writing the very word of God. Parang sila yung typewriter. Pag walang nag-click, walang maire-record. And that is the same thing. So that is what we call the doctrine of inspiration. And that inspiration was preserved from generation to generation. And we call that the doctrine of preservation. And as we read the Word of God with the Holy Spirit will make us understand the Word of God. And we call that the doctrine of illumination. That is the reason why we can know God's Word even though it is an extraordinary book. But sad to say, even though the Bible is filled with evidence that it is true and accurate, still people does not want to believe in the Word of God. Do you know why? Because people cannot accept what the Word of God is saying about them. What? That we are all sinners and come short of the glory of God. That we are doomed and going to hell. And they do not want that there is a person who can save them because they want to do it themselves. Why? Because there is always pride in the heart of all people. That is why they do not want the Bible, because the Bible condemns us. But deep within, if we will just ask ourselves, we believe that we are good. But the Bible declares, there is none good. No, not one. Not even one. Only Jesus is good, because he was not mere man, but he is the God-man. Therefore, he is good. Can we really trust the Bible? Well, we have fulfilled prophecies in the Bible. You see, when Israel was destroyed, they said, that's it. There will be no more Israel. But God prophesied in Jeremiah chapter 30, verse number 3. Can we go there? Jeremiah chapter 30, verse number 3. The Bible says, and the word, no, 33. For lo, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, saith the Lord. And I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and they shall possess it. There is a prophecy in the Bible that he is going to regather Israel. But when Titus destroyed Jerusalem, they said, that is the end of Jerusalem. There is no way that Jerusalem will become a nation again, because they were already scattered abroad, and there is no way, they said, that they can know that they are really genuinely Israel, because they have lost their identity. But you see one thing, Israel is distinctively Israel. You cannot mistook them for other people. They are indelibly Israel. Okay, so compare this to Ezekiel chapter 34, 11 to 13. Ezekiel 34, 11 to 13. Parang maliwanag naman yung Ezekiel, ano? Ayun. For thus saith the Lord God, behold, I, even I, will both search my sheep and seek them out. You see, he said, I'm going to search for them. And I am going to seek them out. 12. As a shepherd seeketh out his flock in the day that he is among his sheep that are scattered, so will I seek out my sheep and will deliver them out of all places where they have been scattered in the cloudy and dark day. 13. And I will bring them out from the people and gather them from the countries, and will bring them to their own land and feed them upon the mountains of Israel by the rivers and in all the inhabited places of the country. And pass forward to 1948. The United Nations declared Israel as an independent nation. Amen? So that's the accuracy. That is the prophetical fulfillment of the Word of God. Not to mention all the fulfilled prophecies in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. According to Micah, He will be born in Bethlehem. And He was born in Bethlehem. According to Isaiah, He will be of the branch of the root of David. And He came from the lineage of David. There are 39 prophecies fulfilled in one day in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ when He was crucified. So everything that God has predicted happened and will continue to happen. Amen? You cannot point out one prophecy in the Bible that was not fulfilled. Why? Because the author of the Bible is the Word of God. And yet, people will not even believe the Word of God. We have accurate science in the Bible. You see, during that time, the people believed on flat earth. And even at this time, you see how crazy people are. There are proponents still of flat earth theory. They have a flat mind. But even though people during that time believe that the earth is flat, the Bible already taught that the earth, the shape of the earth is round. Look at Isaiah chapter 40, verse number 22. Isaiah 40:22. The Bible says, "It is He that seated upon the circle of the earth." You see, and the inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers that stretch out the heaven as a curtain and spread them out as a tent to dwell in. You see, He says, "It is He that seated upon the circle of the earth." And during that time, they believe the reason why we have Atlas, the legendary carrier of the earth, is because they cannot imagine that how was the earth positioned or who is carrying us. They said that Atlas is carrying the earth while he was standing on a big turtle, and then the turtle is standing on this and this and that until they reach the bottom. So that is what they said. But you know, the Bible already said that the earth is floating in space and it is not being held by anything except the power of God. Job chapter 26 and verse number 7. "He stretched out the north over the empty place and hangeth the earth upon nothing." You see, during the time that they cannot observe the earth, but the Bible already taught them that the earth is floating in outer space. And when they found that, many scientists became a believer of the Word of God. Why? Because accurate science can be found in the Word of God. Amen? You see, the turning point of all of this is when Einstein discovered the formula E=mc². Because in the Bible, there was a prophecy that the earth will be destroyed by fire. And they said, that is impossible. The earth cannot be destroyed by fire because most of the earth is composed of water. And it is impossible to consume water by fire. And when E=mc² was discovered, it stated that the atom can be split, and when it is split spontaneously, then it will turn into one great combustion, and in the twinkling of an eye, the earth is destroyed by fire, because even water is composed by molecule, and in that molecule there are elements and there are atoms. That is the principle of atomic bomb. That even though they are only a small particle, but once you harness and split them, they can be very, very destructive. You know why the Bible says that it can be destroyed by fire? Because God is the one who created the earth, and He knew how to destroy the earth. Amen? So it is accurate in science, not only that, but practical truths. You see, before we go there, sometimes, you know, during that time, they are trying to count the number of the stars during the olden times. But those who knew the Word of God did not even bother to count it. Why? Because in Genesis chapter 15, verse number 5, It's already mentioned in the Bible. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. The seed of Abraham is innumerable as the stars in heaven. So they are uncountable. You cannot count them. And it is accurately written in the Word of God. And even the scientists can attest that as long as they observe the universe, they can see that there are even innumerable galaxies that are existing in our universe, and we barely touch the fringe of the universe. That is why it is already written in the Bible, and it is scientifically correct. We have practical truths from the Word of God, that we are all sinners, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. The principle of sowing and reaping are all in the Bible, and they are practical truths, and even historical accuracies. Don't you know that most archaeologists use the Word of God in order to unearth ancient civilizations? And that happened. If you have a Thompson Bible and you will go to the archaeological area, you will see the thousands of discoveries by many archaeologists who use the Word of God as a guide. Don't you know that David, the existence of David was questioned by so many people? And it was only in 2005 or 2011 that one archaeologist found the palace of David. And that is because of the Bible. So now they are sure that David is really a person who existed in ancient time. But you see, in spite of all these things, people do not want to believe in the Word of God because they do not believe in God. That is why the Bible says in 14:1 of Psalms that they are fools, because they said in their hearts that there is no God. But praise God, we can enjoy it if we will put our faith that the Bible is not an ordinary book. Amen? Number three, know that the things in the Bible will be known in due time. Listen, the reason why so many people are not enjoying the Bible, even Christians, is because there are things that they could not understand. And you see, when people could not understand, it somehow make them lose their appetite in the Word of God. Because they will try everything that they could to just understand the Word of God, but that will not happen. Why? The author is an infinite God given to finite men. And therefore, if the author is infinite and we are finite, there are so many mysteries that we will not understand today. You know why? Because if we can understand the whole Bible, we will even question the divinity or the divine authorship of the Bible. We will even say, how is it that the Bible is the Word of God if I can understand it all? You see, that's the reason why we cannot understand some things in the Bible except if they are revealed to us by God. So how can we enjoy the Word of God? Put our faith that in due time, we are going to understand what the Word of God is teaching us. Amen? But the most important thing is that because God has spoken, then we believe and we obey. Listen to this. It is not our business to understand everything from the Word of God, but it is our business to obey everything that the Word of God says. That is our business. You do not have to understand it, to believe it and to obey it, because knowing the author is an enough assurance that whatever he says, it will be for our good. Amen? So that is how we must treat the Word of God. Number four, know that repeated reading and studying is the key to understanding most of the Word of God. So how can we really enjoy and understand the Word of God? You must read it and read it and read it again and again and again and again. How many times have you read the Word of God through? There may be people here who have not yet read the Word of God through in his or her life. Nabasa mo na yung Bible? O may mga nalaktawang ka, nilaktawang ka. Pagdating sa numbers, hindi naman na importante to. Ang hirap nga bigkasin eh. Di ba? Pagdating dun sa mga, sa Song of Solomon, medyo mahirap intindihan. Pero na lang kung ano ka, yung deeply, madly in love. Ayan, medyo tsatsagain mo. Kasi magsusulat ka eh. Kukuha ka rin ng mga, ano, ng mga phrases. Ayan. My love, yung mga dove's eye. Ayan, yung mga ano dyan eh. Kukunin ko. Maka interesado ka. Pero kung hindi ka naman in love, lalagpasan mo lang yung Song of Solomon. Ayan, tsaka yung mga ibang parts dito sa Bible. But the key to understand the Word of God is to read, study, and study, and study without stopping, because the Word of God is like a gold mine that whenever you dig, you're going to find nuggets. Yung unti-unting ginto, nuggets of gold and nuggets of gold here and there. And once you combine them, you're going to have a big lump of gold that you will enjoy by the grace of God. It is like a well that no matter how deep you dig, you're not going to reach the bottom of it. That is how rich the Word of God. That's why there is no stopping when we study the Word of God. So again, how are we going to do that, Pastor? Number one, we must study it seriously and exhaustively. Rightly dividing the word of truth. When you encounter something that you do not fully or really understand, rightly divide the word of truth. Use all the principle of interpretation, context, word study, comparing scripture with scripture. Use all the methods. And when once you do that, then the Bible is going to be like a puzzle that is being completed right in your very eyes. We must search it. As Jesus says in John 5:39, search the scripture. You do not search the scripture to give an answer, just to give an answer. You search the scripture first to learn, to grow, and then to be a blessing to other people. You see, this is a temptation to us preachers. We only look at the Word of God because we want material to preach. That is sometimes our fault. That is why we are feeding people when we ourselves are hungry. Because we are not feeding ourselves with the Word of God. That's why the Bible says meditation. Meditation is for our self-edification. When we meditate upon the Word of God, we are feeding ourselves. And once we are fed and full, then we have now the ability to feed other people. Nakakita ka na ba ng gutom na nagpakain ng gutom? Hindi niya mapapakain, nanginginig siya sa gutom eh. Matatapon lang yung pagkain. Maglilimos ka ba sa taong nagpapalimos? What if a beggar will approach you and ask for alms? And let us say that beggar is Andre. Will you give him money or food? Especially if you say, alms, please, alms. I have not tasted food for 1 month. And then you will look at him and say, my, were you an elephant before? You will not be convinced. He cannot convince anybody. And the same thing with us. If we will not feed ourselves first with the Word of God, no matter how we preach, there is no way that we can convince other people. You are like a salesman who is selling pills that will make people fat when you are so skinny yourself. Pampataba, pampataba. And then, nagbebenta sino? Si Sir Lily. Hindi, medyo mataba ka na eh. Pwede ka na magbenta nun eh. Pampatangkad, pampatangkad. Alam niyo na kung sino nagbebenta. Si Luwa, lalapitan ka. Pampaputi, pampaputi. Oh, ang bebentahan si Mili. Abi, paano siyang bibili? Eh, si Mon pa nagbenta. Pampaputi, pampaputi. Abi, asan yung nagtitinda? Ito po ako, asan ka? Ngingiti ako. Ah, ayun na yung pala siya. We will not be able to convince people if we ourselves will not first feed on the Word of God. Amen? So search the Word of God. Feed from the Word of God and then proclaim the word of God. We must compare scripture with scripture. We must listen and we must test. Look at Acts 17:11. Ang sabi ng Bible, Acts 17:11, there were more noble than those in Thessalonica in that they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scripture. See? Nakinig na, sinearch pa scripture. This should be our attitude when we listen to the preaching of the word of God. You listen to the preacher, you absorb what the preacher is saying, you take note of what the preacher is saying, and once you get home, you search the scripture. Why? To ascertain if it is true or not. And the reason why so many Christians are deceived is because they are contented with the words of the preacher. And they will not even bother to look at the word of God if those things were so. Tinuro, kamukha nung tinuro ko yung tribulation giving, wala man lang nag-search. Tinanong man lang sana ako, Sir, Pastor, saan sa Bible na inutos sa church na ibigay ang mga alahas? Tinanong man lang ako, Pastor, saan sa Bible na dapat naming ibigay ang isang taon na buo naming sweldo? Maahawa ka naman. Ano kakainin namin kung buong buwang sweldo ibibigay namin sa church? Mahal namin, we love the church. Make no mistake about it. But God will supply the needs of the church without not at our expense. You see, if I'm going to make this building beautiful and make your life harder, where is the justice in that? Where is godliness in that? Oh, even if you will not eat for a week, as long as we take care of the place of where we worship God. Listen, even without this place, we can worship God. You see, we are so into the external and we are not looking at the internal anymore. We are so into the physical and we do not care for the spiritual anymore. For us, blessings are the things that we can see. And we have forgotten that the most important things are actually the things that we cannot see because they are eternal in nature. And that is the blessing that we should shoot for from God. That's why you need to know, you need to understand, you need to search, you need to ask questions, ask tough questions. And let the preachers convince you that they know what they are talking about. And once you know that they know, then by the grace of God, you obey because what they are preaching is the word of God. Amen? That is how we can make our lives better and our relationship easier in the church. We must meditate upon it. I mentioned that in Psalms chapter 1, verse number 2. And we must do it regularly. Not only once a week. You see, sometimes again, as preachers, this is our fault. We study the Bible or the Word of God Saturday night. And we will not sleep until 11, 12, 1, or even 2 o'clock. We scramble to arrange everything because we give time only on a Saturday for what we are going to preach. We call that cramming. And God will not accept our preaching if we're like that. My teacher in a homiletic said that after you preach Sunday, the next thing that you need to do is to prepare your preaching for the next Sunday. And that is the amount of preparation that we need to do, especially if you are preaching 2, 3, 4, or even 5 messages every week. That's why you will see how laborious the work of a preacher is. And now you will appreciate why in Acts chapter 6, they said, we will not serve tables. We will continually give ourselves to prayer and the word. Why? Because that will consume almost all of your time. And you have no more time to serve tables. How much more to serve Congress? If you have no more time anymore. Amen? If you a time of leisure and all of these things may be acceptable, but mixing the temporal with the eternal is something that should not happen. Even the song says that, meron bang tuwid ang isip na naglinis at nagbihis, ngunit ang isinuot ay dati niyang damit. Ginagawa nun dito yan. Ang alak na mamahalin kung kailangan mang isalin, ang paglalagyan mo ba'y tapayang lumaring. Meron daw bang tuwid ang isip? Is your mind right if you're going to mix those things that should not be mixed together? That's why we need to focus. We need to understand. And we need to do what God is asking us to do. Amen? So read your Bible every day. And once you do that, you're going to learn more. How can I do that? Read a good Bible, of course, King James, with concordance, much better, so that you can follow through. I have a Thomson chain reference. Of course, the author of this is Thomson, the reference, but the Bible is authored by God. But there is, in his chain reference, there is a guide that once a word is used, there is a chain that goes through the Bible regarding the use of that word. So it can help enhance your studying of the Word of God. Some use Scofield, but you have to be careful. You need to know the doctrine first, because Scofield have different doctrines. He believes in universal church and other things. So you have to at least have this thing so that you can really understand it. How will you read it? You can do it by books. I usually recommend reading the book of John first, and then Romans, and then Old Testament, coupled with some New Testament books. And then by topic, if you need to know about abortion, you get a topical concordance that says abortion, and then there are verses there that you can look at and you can study. So you can use it, study it topically. By doctrine, justification, regeneration, and you look at the verses that are teaching this. Or you can use it by chapters, by verses, verse by verse. This is what we call exposition. By character study, you example, study the life of Moses, and you look at the concordance and look at all the verses that pertains to Moses. Then you will understand and really know Moses, his life, his history, everything that goes about the life of Moses. Or even word study, when the word is used, you can look at all the words that that word is used, and then you can have what you call a word study, and you will understand the Word of God better, and you can be a blessing to other people. Number 5, know that the light of its teaching must be applied in daily life. I will not elaborate. I preached about this yesterday, and Jong emphasized it today, that whatever we learn from the Word of God, in order for us to enjoy it, it must be applied in our lives. Amen? Because without application, then we are not going to experience the power of the Word of God and the power of the author of the Word of God. So we should have a good attitude when we study the Word of God. Two verses, Acts 9:6 and John 2:5. Let us look at Acts chapter 9, verse 6 first. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? When you read the Word of God, you must have an attitude of asking God to reveal to you what he wants you to do, and be sure to do it. Do not ask God, Lord, what is your will? And once he showed you his will, then you're not going to do it. Because Acts 9:6 should be compared to John chapter 2 and verse number 5. And this is what John 2:5 says. His mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. Do not read the Word of God without a desire to obey the Word of God, because it's going to be frustrating. But if you desire to obey the Word of God, then there will be joy. And then lastly, know that reliance to the Holy Spirit is the key to understanding the Word of God. Proverbs 3, 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. You see, many Christians today interpret the Word of God according to their own understanding, without applying the principles of proper interpretation. Kaya nga mga kapatid, we opened our eyes when we got saved into the teaching of tithing, that a Christian is required by God to give his or her tithe to the church. And we heard this so many times in our lives that we blindly believe it and follow it without really understanding what tithing is. When somebody teaches tithing, the first question that you need to ask is this: how many kinds of tithes are there in the Bible? You ask him first. If he cannot answer that, ask the second question is, what is your authority to teach me about tithing if you yourself have not studied yet about tithing? If he happened to know and answer you that, oh, there are three kinds of tithing in the Bible. Second question, what is the tithing that is commanded to us as Christians or as a church? Second question. That will be very hard to answer. Why? Because the three kinds of tithing is the festival tithing, the tithing that has something to do with taxation, and then the tithing that is for the poor and the strangers or benevolent tithing. So, none of this is being applied in the church. What is being applied in the church is a different kind of tithing. So that is why you will understand that the person teaching tithing does not really understand what he's teaching. But if you will study the Word of God, then you will understand, yes, I can tithe, but I will give it according to the desire of my heart, willfully, without any force, without being forced, without any twisting of the Word of God. I will pattern my giving of tithing according to Abraham, when without any law he willingly gave to Melchizedek. And if I do not want to do that, it is my liberty, because giving is all about being willing, and it's all about my stewardship, and it is all about my proving my love to my God. There is actually no amount, fixed amount, when it comes to giving. So, Pastor, I can just give $1. Why not? But you are proving something by doing that. And it's so sad that you have been a Christian for a long time, and until now you do not understand that everything belongs to God. You see, the one who posted this said, people who do not tithe do not understand that tithing is not giving. He said, it is returning what belongs to God. Really? Question. How much it is that belongs to God? If that is your belief, your attitude, you must give all to God, because everything belongs to God, including yourself. You see? That is why we need to not to rely in our own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. You will understand, you will know what to do as you put your faith, your trust, and confidence wholly to God. Then the Holy Spirit will have a free reign in your heart, and he will cause you to understand everything that you are studying from the Word of God, that God has revealed to each and every one of us. Let me end in Psalms 119 verse 18. Psalms 119 verse number 18. The Bible says, open thou mine eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. So it is only God who can cause us to understand his word. And once we understand his word, Joshua 1:8 will happen in our lives. Amen. Shall we stand up? Every head's bowed, please.